Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. It's been several days now since the day of love, and some teenagers are probably still on a high, celebrating their first Valentine's for their first love. But what is love really for the young ones these days? Is it different for them as it was for us? Or is it just as melodious and pure and patient even now in the digital age? And if it's not, what are the pitfalls? We talked to parenting and relationship consultant Maribel Dionisio for the answers. This is Talk Back on ANC. Hi, Maribel. Nice to see you again. It's been a while since you were last here on the show.
Yes.
All right, so let's begin. Is it the same experiencing love then and now? If it's not, what are the differences?
Well, love is still the same, but I guess the process now is different because of the digital age, you know. So they can send their messages. If you're shy, you can send your messages through a text, you know. Or if you want to look for a friend, there's a way to find a friend without having all that, you know, that embarrassment and, you know, that shy, especially shy people.
Right.
Maybe the digital age is going to be helpful for them to be able to send a message without having to face the person.
Mm-hmm.
So, but also there's a downside to it because there are some who, you know, they propose, you'll be my boyfriend or my girlfriend or...
Mm-hmm.
online or by texting.
Yeah.
So sometimes they don't even have the opportunity to meet a person, you know, maybe through some few chats, and then they say we're on.
Mm-hmm. And is it also quite different now because online you can be a totally different person.
Correct.
And that's pretty dangerous.
Yes, that's the dangerous part there, that you're not, if you haven't met this person really face to face, or you don't even know the background of this person since you met the person really online, then the danger there is truthfulness, because somebody can post it or just write all sorts of the correct answers and give the information, and yet might be false love or maybe a hurting kind of relationship that may happen.
So in a nutshell, Maribel, what has a digital age done to teenage love?
Well, it has made it more difficult, I think, for parents to begin with, because unlike before, you know who's that person.
Correct.
You know, they come to the house, you see them maybe in the school, you see them, you know, but now the parenting skills really have to be heightened, because what parents would wish is their kids, their teenage kids, will inform them, will share with them who's this person they're talking to, what happened, and all that. So the listening skills of the parents have to be very, very good.
Mm. And it's not just listening in terms of, you know, using your sense of hearing.
Yes.
It's
yes.
really observing,
you know,
your kids. And
saying, hey, I see that you know, the glow in your face.
Mm-hmm.
It looks like somebody has a crush on you, or you have a crush on someone.
Mm-hmm.
What's it like?
But here's the thing, Maribel. Teenagers now, and even younger ones, they value their privacy now more than ever. So that it's becoming, or has it been harder for parents to, you know, pierce that digital divide and parent as online as well as they do in reality?
Maybe there's privacy. It's normal for teenagers to really desire that privacy. Don't open my phone, you know, don't come in my room.
So you'll what's have a to parent not. To do?
But the parents will have to know how to precisely connect. And this is part of the parenting skills. I don't think it's about really digital. It's really how a parent will talk to the child. Oh, okay. I will, because if there's a positive relationship to begin with, which we've been talking about here, you know, then it should be easier, it'd be easy for the parent to connect still with the teenager.
Mm-mm. So you don't have to resort to, you know, putting in spyware or something on your kids' phones.
Well, you still have to do some things to be able to help manage that, to bring out the best in them. Because like, if they just meet a person online, especially if they are teenagers, you know, it can be pretty dangerous. So the wish, I think, or what parents would like to do is, that's why we say, you talk to them like a friend in a sense, but you are still the parent, you know. But
you have to have that authority still.
You don't question, or you do not put them down, you do not judge, you know, because the teenager will say, but I'm making friends, which is normal for all teenagers before and then.
Right.
The process is just different. But see, our intervention of parents have to be heightened, because there are just so many opportunities.
So what do you do? What do you tell parents? You're a parenting consultant, yeah, and I'm sure you've come across a lot of cases like this.
I wish they attended when their kids were, the first 10 years, the two-day basic course on parenting, mm-hmm. basically how to listen, how to connect, how to speak properly. Because if you know how to speak to them and talk to them without judgment, chances are they'll speak and share these things to us now, even if they're teenagers. And then, of course, when they're teenagers, there's another course on updating the parenting skills, because mm-hmm. the parents are also going through their midlife and they have so many things on their head. So
right.
We have to be aware that our focal point has to still be, or part of our, part of our priorities would be these kids, without them knowing that you're really looking at them and listening to them, in a sense. Mm-hmm. No? We're not, cannot be spying.
That's like a whole universe of Jedi tricks there for
it's an
her parents.
Art of parenting when
exactly.
they're teenagers.
Exactly.
No, yes. But see, you should have had the skills when they were younger and that connection with them so that you will...
There won't be as much of a struggle when they enter their teenage years.
The problem is with parents who were absent the first 10 years because they're still the thinking that, they're still so young, mm-mm. I can threaten them and all that. But mm-mm. now that they're teenagers, you cannot threaten them. So if you didn't shift to that kind of democratic where you listen and talk and there's that fairness and respect, then our teenage years with them can be difficult.
So basically you're saying digital age or otherwise, the foundation really is that relationship between parent and child.
Correct.
So that the parent won't have to adjust to the changing times.
Yes. We were saying before, you still need a network of parents, like if you're in school, know mm-hmm. who are the friends of our kids and who are the parents, get to meet them. Mm. And we say, invite each other to each other's homes, and of course they will connect with them also. Mm. They'll chat with them later on. And if our teens really feel comfortable with us, they'll tell us, hey, I'm chatting with so-and-so now, and say hi first, mom. Mm. And,
let's present a case study here. Teenage boy or girl spending a lot of time online, obviously talking to
someone
that she or he may be interested in.
Correct.
And you sense it as a parent that it may go, further than just acquaintance.
Okay.
What do you do?
Then the first thing is, did you set certain guidelines? The guideline I encourage parents to mention to their kids as young as 9 years old. Mm. You can collect, you can make friends. What kind of friends do you like? Or what kind of friends do you have right now? What are they like? Mm-hmm. If they say, I like them to be sporty or musically inclined, so what's the interest? What kind of personality? You want somebody who's talkative or quiet mm-hmm. or respectful? So, because the kind of friends they have now of the same gender will most likely be the kind of friends they like later on among their crushes.
Okay.
When the romantic part comes in also. There should be a similarity. When it's very different, mm-hmm. then you'll want to check how come.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Maybe our children need something that this person is offering.
Is providing, yeah.
Yes. I've heard this for a lot of teens. Tita, I should not have a crush on this guy, but how come I have a crush?
Mm.
Then when we checked it out, the kind of attention he was giving you was something that you really needed because you didn't have it in your family in your growing up years.
Mm-hmm.
So you can be drawn to somebody who's not really in your qualification list, but because you have a need that this person is providing.
Is that okay, though?
No, because that's not really real love. I mean, it's because once you outgrow, if you outgrow, you're not like this person. Not only that, you might be using each other, or this is not a healthy relationship.
Mm.
And especially if, online they meet somebody who's really more affectionate, more caring, and then much older than you. And because this teenager didn't have that attention, then, we have these potential problems here.
There's one... tip that I was reading through the tips that you sent over, and there was one tip that says strengthen your self-worth.
Correct.
Know who you are, what you want, and heal your hurts and pains over your growing up years. But here's the thing, Maribel, how will teenagers go about this when itself
I know
is a period of self-discovery?
Yes. Correct. And this is the role of the parents to continually work at this with their teens.
Mm.
Not really telling them, hey, we have to build your self-worth or strength.
Yeah,
the
yeah.
parents have to be more affirming, recognizing their strengths, saying these things and, you know, acknowledging whatever accomplishment or contribution they're able to work on, no judgment. So, because you will eventually know if this child is pretty confident, because the more confident a teenager is, they will not submit to peer pressure. Mm. And if we have a good relationship, chances are they will listen to our guideline of, you know, I mentioned it's all right to collect and have crushes, but have your first boyfriend or girlfriend when you're about 19. And they keep saying, why 19? Because that's the last number with the word teen. If you say 20, 21 to a 15 or 14-year-old, that sounds old to them.
No, and what if, let's say, like for me, for example, you know, I had my boyfriend younger than when I was 19. I mean, and how can I now tell my kids that you're supposed to have your first girlfriend at 19 when mama clearly didn't follow?
Yes, then you say mama clearly did not follow. I did not follow the guideline, and this was the negative effect, if there was, you know, to let them know. And because the negative effect is you are curtailed. I mean, your movement is curtailed. There are less people, maybe, because an exclusive relationship, you're supposed to focus.
So that's
on
the
this
angle.
Person.
That's the angle that we should be able to sell to the kids.
Yes.
That it's all about them, really.
Right.
It's all about you know, knowing yourself.
Yes.
And not getting tied down.
Uh-huh.
Because
uh-huh.
this is supposed to be a fun.
This is supposed to be a fun stage of really meeting a lot of people.
Yeah.
And besides, I say, then I add, the marrying age now, encourage age, is their late 20s, if not 30s.
That's true.
So if you have a boyfriend or girlfriend at 15, at 14, mm-hmm. and you'd be tied down for 4 or 5 years, this is a period to really collect and really, you know, discover more about other people. In the mm-hmm. process, you'd be discovering a lot also about your preferences, your likes, your personality.
Do you get a sense, Maribel, that teenage love now is faster? Compared
it
to
it can move a lot faster because of, you know, you get information immediately about the other person.
Mm.
And yet, it can be difficult because they have to confirm that information. You want to still look for a common friend or some connection to say that, oh, okay, this person is legitimate.
Mm-mm.
You know, it's not fake news.
Right.
So, and parents need to help their teens in that regard.
Mm.
And so you tell parents, with teenagers, create opportunities for them to meet people face to face. Create
right.
parties, sports activities, musical events, invite them to the homes. That's the old thing that we still have to do.
Mm-mm.
Because if they have enough people to talk to, then they'll not maybe want to go online. I mean, this is more fun, these people out here.
Right. When you talk to teens and, you know, teenagers come to you for guidance,
yes.
what do they tell you about how they're experiencing love these days?
Well,
is it difficult?
It's difficult if the parents are difficult. It starts with the house rule.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not allowed, or I cannot. I have to focus on studies. You know, parents now can be so too much on the studying and wanting them to really achieve in school.
Mm.
But see, teenagers, while we are in school, yes, we need to make friends. So that's why I have a life plan that I was showing a while ago.
Mm.
You know, if you'll have 4 or 5 columns, I put it here in this book that we wrote, my husband and I, Alan and I, put together. It's basically to really to show, you know, if you're now grade 10, grade mm-hmm. 11, you know, collect friends, have special friends, and age 19, you'll have your boyfriend or girlfriend. So if with your 11-year-olds, you try working on this already now and encourage them, if they see it, yeah, no. And many times when they see it written down, they say,
yeah.
Yeah, no, why should I have a boyfriend or girlfriend early? And let them know what is it out there that
mm-hmm.
they can discover.
Mm-hmm.
But see, usually
because
those...
Because sometimes we project, the parents project the anxiety onto the kids.
Yes, yes.
And that spells a lot of trouble
right.
already.
So the parents have to look into themselves and have mm-hmm. their own sessions.
Yeah.
You know, maybe their insecurities or their worries. I know, like teenage pregnancy is on the rise.
Mm-hmm.
So, but see, it's because have you... Talk to your children about, you know, the birds and the bees, you know, how babies are made and, you know, how to protect yourself.
Yeah.
We have to talk to them. We cannot rely on the school alone. School is doing something, but see, parental influence is still Very important.
Don't outsource the raising of your children.
Exactly. Do not outsource.
Yeah. We're going to talk about peer pressure in a bit. You kind of touched on it a while ago. But first, we have to take a quick break. While there's no definitive survey yet on Filipino teenagers and their views on love and attraction, a recent poll for Filipino adults could provide some insights. Talk back on ANC. We'll be right back. Stay with us, please. Still on Talk Back here on ANC. Adult Filipinos mostly happy about their love life based on a recent Valentine's survey. Could that be the trend too among Filipino teenagers? Let's ask our guests here in the studio, parenting and relationship consultant Maribel Dionisio. So are they? Are teenagers happy?
That's the adult, no?
Yeah, that's the adults. But are teenagers happy, at least those that come into your office and talk about love and their love life? Are they happy?
I'm sure there's a good chunk there that they're happy, and looking at Katipunan this past week, all the red balloons there and the flowers around the area, but there's a sizable number of parents who are really trying to learn and working really at the relationship at their children, because this is really a huge ingredient to that happy relationship also of the teenager in their love life, when they're allowed to meet other people and interact. And but if parents are overly anxious or they don't even know their children,
which is
then
the
that
worst.
Becomes really a problem, like a nightmare for them when they start falling in love, they go out and you know, you don't know the company.
A while ago, you were talking about peer pressure. There's such a thing as peer pressure to get into a relationship, right?
Yes.
Has that changed over the years, or is it basically
the
same?
It's still there. And you get pressured, especially if, I'm the only one that doesn't have a boyfriend or girlfriend, so I should have one. But if your self-worth, again, is in place, and those teens and even young adults, when their self-worth is in place, you say, it's okay. Mm. And then they watch their other friends, oh, they're breaking up. Okay, that's why I should not. I should be careful. And I should. So those who are guided properly by their parents and have a healthy self-worth are able to say no to early relationships or, you know, the teenage relationship. And they'll mingle and meet and meet a lot of people. That's why there are school organizations. These are opportunities for you to meet different kinds of people and know who you are.
So obviously it takes two to tango. A girl, for example, says, no, I'm not ready, right? How should the boy take it?
Well, hopefully it's a healthy self-worth too, and he can say, it's okay, but can we just be friends, you know? So, and that's some that have that worry. You know, some kids will say, I really get very hurt, or they blackmail you. So we have to teach our kids how not to get trapped, you know? How to just say, I'm sorry. Well, we have to learn. That's why in this teen crush book, the chapter one is I have a crush. And chapter two is I have a crush, but my crush doesn't like me.
Mm-hmm.
So that's ouch.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we have to take care of the self-worth of our teens, so that if their crush doesn't like them, it's all right. Let's look for the next candidate. All right.
Mm-hmm.
But the next chapter is I have someone has a crush on me, but I don't like him or her. Okay. So how do you turn down firmly but gently? I mean, you know, we still have to be respectful, because that person has feelings, so it's like a heartbreak as well.
So basically it all boils down to self-worth, but where do you get that self-worth? How your parents were able to build
in the family,
you up
inside
the family.
Still inside the family, and the self-worth of the teens are really still very fragile. And that's why, you know, talking to our kids and letting them know about what they're good at and affirming them And, you know, what we do when we did when our kids were teenagers, we invited other teenagers to join us for an outing. We have always an import, we call it. And they have more fun because some parents still say, no, I want just us. But the teenagers don't want just us. They want other people.
And we have to be open.
And we have to be open to that because that's a way how to get them with us in some, you know, whether it's a local trip or...
All right. Now, with social media, I want to touch on this before we go.
Sure.
One can be in a relationship in a snap, which also makes it easier to say yes to a long-distance relationship, almost never seeing each other, just making a connection through social media. Is that advisable, having an LDR with another person?
Well, if you have a teenager and that's an LDR, the parents are happy because... they will not see each other. Just it's like just chatting, you know.
So parents should encourage or no? But you still have to find out.
You still have to find
who
out
who that person is.
But at least you know if the person's really far away, then it's a lot of chatting. Okay.
Yeah.
But because if they say, but you know, because of text, then we can connect. And but you want a person who's there in front of you also.
Mm-mm.
You know, someone you can have fun with, you play bowling, you go badminton or whatever activity. But yes, when it's teenagers, that's all right. But when you are in your 20s or 30s or thinking of marriage, LDR, absolutely not. You need to meet the person, I say, 5 times a week to be able to get to know really this person.
All right, finally, if there's one thing excuse me, that both parents and teenagers should keep in mind as they deal with teenage love in the digital age, what should that be?
Well, you have to work on your relationship, that there's respect, there's openness, and we listen, and we know how to talk properly. There are no put-downs, no shaming, no blaming, but we can negotiate. We can talk about these things. And please read more about relationship. And for schools, you know, we give one of our bestsellers is the teen, what's it called? This parenting the teenager and the midlife parent. So,
so interesting.
But for those who are kids who are 5, 6 years old, don't say that matagal pa.
Mm-mm.
Better learn, get the basic course on parenting now, and I hope really schools will, you know, require, if not strongly encourage parents, because it can make a difference to enjoy your children. At any stage of life when you have the information.
Well, Maribel, it's always nice to see you. Maribel Dionisio, their parenting and relationship consultant, joining us here on Talkback. Thanks again.